the art that I practice is called Kaze Arashi Ryu. And of course, I came to Kaze Arashi Ryu after being around different arts, and none of them would satisfy me or give me the confidence in a real violent situation. There was always doubts because the arts that I learned were not a complete art. And then I happened to find Kaze Arashi Ryu by accident. And anyway, once I joined the class and I met my instructor, I just never could leave it. Because there were times when I felt like leaving it because it was difficult to learn at certain times. But then I decided, no, I'll stay on and see where I go. And I'm so happy I stayed where I go. And of course, Kaze Arashi Ryu is a warrior art. And it is a traditional art where there is no taking of shortcuts or saying, oh, this is an old technique, let's get rid of it. We don't need it, you know. So there's nobody has cut anything from the art. Everything, the art that was taught years ago is the same that's taught today. But we don't know what the future will be because we do have others coming up in the art and how they will and what they will do, because there's nobody who can go and see what these people are doing. So we're hopeful that the art will continue the way it is. And since it is an ancient art, it is a martial art of the samurai. And the samurais, you know, were taught certain things, and whereas the ones who were their leaders were not taught the whole art, because the samurai was nothing but a killing machine. All he knew was how to cut somebody's head off. And he was a warrior, that's it, he knew nothing else. So they had to know that the people who command them know much more than they can. That was the fear. Otherwise the animals would turn on them. So the whole art was, you know, taught only to you know, like the big commanders in the army or the shoguns and so forth. The others would only learn a little bit, but everybody else, you know, in the leadership position would learn the whole art. And of course, you know, the art, we use the word art, and everybody in the martial art world uses the word art. But the word art is really has no meaning in a lot of martial arts because there is no art part to it. It's only the physical part, which is just to hurt somebody. And that can be done without having, you know, to learn an art, because you could just buy a gun and shoot somebody. And you don't need to learn the art. But as, you know, when we say an artist, we talk about a person playing, let's say, a piano or a guitar or any musical instrument. Why is he called an artist? Because he has to study in depth the theory, you know, of what it is, you know, he is playing, and the music part of it, learn the music, and then he has to practice over and over and over again. It's not like my teacher showed me how to play the scale today, that's enough, I'm good at it now. I know such and such a scale, so I'm good at it. No, if you know something, you're not good at it. You know something and you know how to project it and how to use it for that particular intent, you learned that. And you can do it, you know, time and time again efficiently, then you know it. But simply saying, I know it or I've seen it, does not make one an expert in anything. You know, like I could go to college and I could get a PhD and whatever, and I could walk out with my degree and say, oh, I went to PhD. And after that, I never kept up, you know, reading other articles or, you know, finding out more about the subject and doing. So once my learning stopped, my PhD stops, because I'm not going any further. And if I don't go any further, I'm not going to become better. And if I don't become better, it might as well I've not had that degree. So it's the same way in martial arts. Once you come, a lot of people come to, they get their black belt and they say, oh, I'm a black belt now. And also the public, the general population out there, thinks that when somebody says he's a black belt, like, oh my God, you know, he's something fantastic, that, ooh, we better be careful with him. But in a true martial art world, a black belt is nothing but somebody who has just finished, say, to compare to a high school. And in order for him to really, really, really become better, and most people will tell you that it's a study of a lifetime. Because every day, it is not only the physical learning, but it is also the mental learning. And it is also the learning of your own body and your mind. And eventually, when the body, in the beginning, the mind is always afraid that the body is going to get hurt. The mind constantly is fearful of, oh my God, you know, I don't want the body to get hurt because I don't want to feel the pain. If the body does not feel the pain, but it's the mind and the senses, you know, through the senses, the mind feels the pain. So, you have to first train the mind how to accept a lot of things. Because if the mind doesn't function at a given time, something bad happens to you, then the body cannot function. Because the body freezes, the body does not freeze really, the mind that freezes. So you have to, you know, in the beginning stages of the art, you go through a lot of physical, you know, pain. You experience pain of different kind, and then you experience the moves that you have to move according to the different, you know, positions of the violent attack that takes place. So once you have all that part ready, and after you become a black belt and you go through a lot of learning, then what happens is you no longer are that much afraid of the physical. In other words, you will not say, oh my God, if that person hits me, what am I going to do? You're no longer going to think of yourself as somebody who is going to get hit, but you're always going to think of yourself as somebody, if somebody hits me, I'm going to deal with it. So you no longer have the fear that you had. And that is one of the reasons a lot of people go into martial arts in the beginning. I want to learn to fight. I want to learn so that nobody can hurt me or nobody can touch me, you know. That is the main reason for a lot of students. But those people, a lot of them will come and they learn a few things and they'll feel very confident that they can do anything and they'll quit. But then there are others, which is only 5% of the martial art student that ever, you know, join a school, 5% of them will stay on and go on to learn more to see where this will lead them. And eventually they'll also find that we will never see the end of it because there is no end to knowledge. And same thing, just because it's martial art, people think, oh, kick, punch, yell and scream, how much longer can it take to learn all that? You know, just goes on and on and on. Like if you say pick numbers 1 through 10 and you want to have a combination of so many numbers, and as you modern people, youngsters know, that's all that computer is based on. Ones and zeros, and look what it is doing. So the same way in, you know, martial arts, you have, you know, the different, at least in Kaze Arashi Ryu, you learn so many different kinds of techniques. It is really difficult to master all of them in a few years because there are so many. And the reason there is so many is because in any given situation of anything, let it be music or you know, sports or martial arts, or if you're, you know, learning some other theoretical subject, you have to know a lot of information in order for you to come up with the right answer. You know, in other words, you just cannot depend on a little bit of knowledge to solve any problem. A different level. Maybe you'll be able to, you know, if you're a high school student, oh, that's fine, 2 plus 2 is 4. You can just whip it out the answer. But if it is something you have not done, you know, a college or something like that, and you have to come up with a complicated, say, even a geometry problem to prove something, the two equilateral triangles you know, or one and the same, you know. To prove that, you know, you have to know why you're, how to prove it, and what are the things that you have to say to prove it, you know. And in other words, you can say angle ABC equals angle CED, you know, and so forth, so on, right, all those things. So what I'm saying is, you have to have knowledge, a lot of knowledge to be good at anything. Mm-hmm. And of course, you need to practice that, you know, almost every day like a musician to get good at it, you know. And once you get good at it, unfortunately, most people are happy, but there are some who will say, I want to know more. Because once you know more, what your mind does to you is it says, what else can I do with this? You know, what else can I do with it? Then, you know, then when you start analyzing it, when I start saying, I think I can find an answer and put a full, you know, a period at the end of it, you won't. And you will eventually learn that you will never be able to put a full stop at the end of the learning and say, oh, here's the end. This is not going to happen. You know, not in true martial arts, okay? Same thing happens in true knowledge of anything you learn in this universe. There is no saying, that's it, a period, end of it. You know, you don't see the end, and you'll never see the end. You know, because since we're talking about martial arts, you know, same thing in martial arts, there is no end to the flow of techniques from one to another, to another, to another. You know, in other words, you can counter, the other person just as smart as you, he does something and you do something, he does something, you don't know where it's going to go. There's no way of telling who is going to win or who is going to lose. When both are truly experts and masters, not the so-called masters and so-called experts, you know. Because if they have limited knowledge, they at some time, their computer in the brain is not going to work. Because it has no foundation, no theory beyond a certain level to analyze the situation quickly and come up with an answer. You know, so as things change, if the knowledge is not there, theoretical knowledge has to be there in order to make the physical, you know. So if they don't have that, and that's what happens in martial arts, as you go higher and higher, you start learning more and more principles. It is no longer, we no longer call them techniques. At least when I teach, I don't call them techniques anymore. I call them as, you know, what shall I say, as knowledge that is going to help you build, you know, and they are principles. And the principles in any martial art is the same principle as if you are a student who's studying, say, physics, you know. What are the forces that act on the world, you know, on anything? What is the act that's acting, you know, when you take a piece of steel and you do this? What is that torque? What is it doing? Okay. Or you take a piece of rod and you, you know, stretch it, you make it tensile, you know, you make it longer and longer. What is the force acting on it? All right. Or you take a big rock or a big slab of anything that is heavy, and you set it on this table, what is the force acting on it? It is the same forces, the same principle that act in martial arts, at least in Kaze Arashi Ryu, as far as all the techniques we do, the controls, okay? And same thing is true of the throws. You can say, you know, take that person and throw him, but how do you throw him, you know? First and foremost thing, you will be able to penetrate the person's defense, and you have to go in. And once you go in, where are the points, you know, that you're going to throw that person? You know the way and the technique of how to throw him, but if you ever notice when you throw somebody, they're always falling here, all right? Or they're falling behind you, you know? So those are the, you know, those are the center points of you, that's where they fall, you know? So you cannot take somebody and throw him there, you know? You cannot take somebody, you can do that, you know, by sacrificing, but you cannot stand and throw somebody. So the point, where are the point, and why? It's because of the balance. Because the person's balanced. So it's not, if you don't understand that principle, that's why a lot of students in the beginning when they want to do Koshinagi, they don't realize they got to come up and here, you know. Or when they do, say, Sumyatoshi, it's back there. Not back there, but back in the center, you know. So they don't realize the principle, and we don't teach them the principles in the beginning anyway, you know, because we know they're in a hurry to learn, and they want to know something, and to keep their interest up, we have to teach them. But later on, you know, when they become higher and higher in rank, then they'll have to know, because when their own students get higher in rank, the student is not going to be very happy with just knowing, do this, because he has done it a million times by the time, you know, he's become a black belt. And then you say to them, oh, this is Sumya, they'll make him do the same thing. Now he's going to say, what makes it work? They're telling me I've done it so many times, everything. But I want to know now, I'm at a stage now, I know the physical movement, but I want to know the theoretical and the reason why. Why does it work? So when you explain to him, this is why it works, and every time he's doing, you know, a throw, he's making sure he's doing this. He's not looking there and trying to throw the person here, you know. Or he's, when he does Sumyatoshi, upper body takedown, he's going to be going there, right there, not over there. So he's going to arrange his body in such a way that the person's hand is pulling, you'll be here and not there. So it is a theoretical knowledge becomes very important, and the principles become very important. Just as the forces in physics that somebody learns, you know, if you're a structural engineer or a mechanical engineer, you have to design things, you have to know the different forces acting on something. And you have, so the same way, at least in Kaze Arashi Ryu, we hope our students, you know, as they go along, we try to teach them as much we know of, but we normally, I'm the only one who uses that comparison of physics to martial arts. And but there may be another instructor who teaches it a different way. And then the whole thing is like in martial arts, the longer you stay with martial art, the you will change to a different person. It is a normal change, it is a change you don't see. You know, in the beginning you were like, come on, I'll fight that guy, I'll go over there and take his face up, you know. And then you get over that, you know, you're no longer, because you're no longer afraid of pain, you're no longer afraid of, you know, that you're going to be defeated. You have all the confidence saying, I think I know. Because the reason also is being that in Kaze Arashi Ryu, the student is told from day one, you will get hurt in a fight, you will get stabbed, you will get shot, be prepared. So mentally, when he's already prepared, you know, he's no longer afraid. But if he's not mentally prepared and he walks around like a lot of martial arts do, I'm the best in the world, nobody can touch me. And the first time he's touched, he loses all confidence. Mm-hmm. So that way also your mind is prepared, like be ready, okay? But you are taught to move such way that if something should make contact with your body, it'll graze you instead of going through you. So if you're grazed, you're still alive and you can still, you know, you'll still be moving and doing what you have to do. So that way, you know, the fear goes little by little by little. So when that physical fear is not there and you're still practicing martial art, even you say to yourself, man, I know all these things. What else is there that I can learn? You know, I've learned all the physical parts and I love it. It's very interesting. You know, I've seen so many different things that I didn't know before. But what else is there that I can do? Of course, then you're also being taught about your center as you go along. And that's when you say, oh, in all these years I've talked about center, and you know, I tried to use it. You know, my instructor always said, your body, you know, if you move your hand, remember your hand and your body are one and the same. And just don't move your hand, but move, you know, since your body is attached to the hand, move your whole body. Put your whole body behind what you're doing. And then breathing, you know, that's also part of your being. So put that breathing in there. All the breathing exercises you'll be taught, you'll be learning and practicing. Okay, let me put it on. So now it's like no longer practicing a technique like before, but now you're putting the whole being into that technique. You're putting your breathing, you're putting your center, you know, and you're always thinking aware of your whole body rather than part of the body, you know. So the same thing, you know, like when you're striking or moving, whatever you're doing, your whole being is moving as one unit. Your mind and your body, you know, are moving as one unit. And that's where your inner strength comes from, also from your breathing. So now you're learning to put your inner strength plus your physical strength to act as one unit, which is much more stronger and which will defeat anybody who cannot deal with you in that way. If they can do the same thing, then it's going to be a question of you feeling them feeling you, and whoever at a fraction of a moment weakens can have, you know, the other person can have the advantage. Otherwise, you know, it's going to be a long drawn, very boring, very slow fight. It's not going to be like in the movies where boom, 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 you know. No, you can't, because, you know, in the most important thing, you know, when two good experts are fighting, they're feeling each other and they're accordingly adjusting, you know, their energies and their movement. So, you know, it's going to be impossible to penetrate that no matter how good you are, because he's just as good as you, you know, and you're as good as him. So somewhere, somehow, somebody has got to weaken a little bit for the other person to take advantage. So then, of course, like I said, it'd be a question of you, you know, putting all these things together and trying to better your physical movements and your mind and your martial arts. Well, once you come to that stage and you have learned all that thing, you know, in the meantime, what also happens is, like, the samurai was always taught that when you go to war, you know, you do not worry about the result of the, you know, the fight you're fighting, whether they are going to be alive or whether they're going to be dead, you know. So when there's no such thought, when there's no thought of living or dying, they will fight with a free mind and fight to the best of them, because they're all focused at that moment of what they're doing. And they're not worried about, oh my God, I gotta go home to my wife or children. They're not. All that they do is fight. Well, in the old days, you know, everybody, you know, the Japanese got a lot of credit for, oh, the samurai soldier always did that. But you look at today's soldier, he does the same thing. If somebody is sent to Iraq tomorrow, a young guy who's 20 years old, you know, he has a little bit of fear and everything, but when he has to pick up that gun and start firing and running, he's not afraid, because he's running to get in position so he can shoot, you know. So it's, you know, in the beginning, like, oh yeah, the samurai warrior, you know. But any soldier who is a warrior, you know, who is a warrior today in any army is, you know, they may not teach them the philosophy of don't think about what happens, but just go there and fight. They don't even have to think that. They just go and fight. Because they know if they go there, they don't fight, it's him or me. You know? So they have to fight. And of course, that may be, you know, example for a soldier, but if you take that example in real life, like it says in the, in one of the, you know, religious books, because I won't bring religion into this here, you know, religious books that, you know, you do not worry about the outcome of what it is you do, you know. And so when you do it that way, you are completely focused. Your mind is free. Your mind is not wavering with doubts. Because when you have doubt, the next step is fear, you know. And when you have fear, you will not be able to do anything. So you don't analyze something, you know, you just say, I have to do this now, at this moment, and I'm going to do it. And do it the best of my ability, without having to worry in the next 10 seconds, am I going to be able to complete this task? I'm just going to, I know how to do it, I'm prepared to do it, and I'm going to do it. Because you may not know the next 10 seconds you might die. You know, because life is, there's no guarantee about death as to when we're going to die. We all hope that we'll live for so many years, but we just really don't know how long we'll live. And so in that way, a person, you know, who's been taught to think like that, he is really always, like, you know, in the present, he's not really worried too much Of course, we all plan the future. We all say, save money to buy a house and to go to college or buy something. We have to. We all do that, you know. But that is only, you know, if you take it in the relationship to time, it's just a flicker, you know. It's not like it's going to go on forever and ever and ever. So, and of course, the martial arts finally will lead you, you know, without your own knowledge, if you've stayed with it for a long time and you have done it and not let the ego get to you, you will automatically will become a person who will become spiritual. Because the human, you know, thing is such that we all know subconsciously and consciously that there is something out there, you know, whether you want to call it God or whatever name, you know, it doesn't matter. You can call it, you know, an air conditioner for all you care. And, you know, it doesn't matter. But that, you know, becomes, you're quite aware of that. And then you become spiritual. The reason is not because all of a sudden, you know, you're religious and, you know, you just want to pray 24 hours a day. But the whole, you become religious and you become more truly religious, where you are compassionate, you know, and where you feel sorry for other people, you know, and you want to help other people, and, you know, and you see somebody in trouble, you want to go and help them. You know? So this takes you to that state where you're no longer worried about, you know, your what people will say if I go and help this person, or if I, you know, don't live a certain way, what will my neighbors say, and things like that. You no longer worry about it, because you're living at a higher plane, higher level, you know. You're living at a level where the most important thing that, you know, is important to you is being helpful and truthful, you know, and help in any way you can, and be truthful in any way you can, and not take advantage of, you know, people who are weak. And of course, then of course, when you have all the qualities, you automatically are a spiritual person, because spirituality does not require you, in my opinion anyway, to constantly pray. Because when you say, oh, well, when you, most people pray, they're always asking for something. You know, they're always asking for something. And I always used to tell them that don't ask God for anything, you know, because everything has been provided. God has provided you with all the food you want to eat. He has provided materials for you to build any house you want, okay, any type of house. He has provided all the raw materials to build airplanes and cars and TV sets and every physical, you know, object in this world. All that is there. And of course, you cannot build a TV set, but he has provided stores that can, you know, where you can go and just pay money and buy. And in order for you to, you know, earn money, he has, you know, he has provided colleges and schools and everything. You can go there, learn, and get a job. So everything is there, but you have to work for it. You know, without working for it, and that's what I say to myself also, do not ask God for anything unless you have worked for it. And the old saying goes, you know, do your best and leave the rest to God. It's very simple, and it's very true. You know, because when I was young, when I was in school, I was learning this thing. I was like, oh, okay, I remember this. But, you know, do your best and leave the rest to God. But now I understand what it means. It means you have to do it, you know. And God, you know, it's like the old jokes that, you know, they say, like this guy was, if your house is flooded, he's down there, you know, on top of his house, and the boat comes by and tells the guy, come on, you know, and then something else comes by and says, and he refuses all of them. A helicopter comes, he refuses. Then he dies. So he tells God, well, I was praying to you. Why didn't you help me? He says, I sent you all those things. You know, so it's the same way. You just cannot sit there and go to church or go to temple and pray to God saying, you know, if I'm sick and I you know, pray to God to help me get better, but I also have to take my medicine. I also have to go see the doctor and see what he gives me and take that medicine. I simply cannot lay in bed and say, help me get better. You know? So the martial arts will lead you towards, you know, eventually will lead you towards thinking like that and towards, you know, being a different person than, you know, another person. Of course, you know, you're just going to live your life the way you want, not bother about somebody else. You're not going to worry about, you know, because you no longer really, your ego is that bloated that it will worry about, you know, what kind of car you drive or what kind of house you live, you know, or what, and even, you know, food, you eat what is necessary and not, you know, like I'm going to a 10-star restaurant, you know. And so it doesn't matter whether you're eating a 10-star restaurant or a no-star restaurant, as long as you like that food. You know, that's the whole important thing.
You focus from inside as opposed right. to
exactly.
society or the outside.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And also, you know, because when if you have no longer have an ego, I think, you know, coming back to eating, you want to eat, you know, to live, but you don't want to live to eat, you know. Because most people, you know, rich people live to eat, you know. And but it makes no sense, you know. You eat different foods, you know, 10 different courses or whatever it is. It does not make you a better person, you know. So the better you'll be, a better person if you start eating 10 courses. You only had 5 courses, and the rest of the money spent on that 5 courses, you gave it to some poor people to you know, buy them food for a day or so, you know, or give it to an organization that feeds poor people that they can help them. Yeah, so you start, you know, becoming like that. It's not going to be overnight. It's going to take, you know, a few years. But if your goal is to reach not only, you know, the physical stage of, you know, of, let's call it martial arts, and then the, you know, the next stage of you working as a whole being and not a separate part of this and my separate part of that, and then you become, when you become a whole being, then nothing matters, but you truly become spiritual because you can see that the only way you can have peace and happiness and everything by having a minimal of things. Because the more physical things you own, the more the load is on your back. And that more that load becomes on your back, the more you will not be spiritual because you don't have time. If you have 5 cars, and if you have a lot of money invested in the stock market and so forth, and if you have, I'm not saying you shouldn't have, you know, but, you know, you have a house and, you know, but all these things, we say a rich person has to worry, oh my God, what about the water system in my house, you know, and what about my stock market, is my broker cheating me, or if the market goes down today, oh my God, the market's down today, how much am I going to lose, you know, so there's always a constant worry, and if you want to be, you know, any human being will have a certain amount of worry. There is no life without worry. But you want to keep that to a minimum. You have to plan your life in such a way that you only have that minimum. And whatever you have in your life that's minimum, if it breaks, if it's stolen or whatever, I don't care about. You are not, you know, married to that thing. You don't live your life for that physical object. And if you, you know, that's what a good system of martial arts will lead you. And that's why you see, not today, but in the old days, when a martial art, you know, a teacher, they called them a master. And what were the masters? They were all priests. If you look at the Shaolin priests, all right, they were all martial artists. If you look a lot of, even today in Nepal, you know, the lamas, a lot of them are martial artists, you know, because they have gone through the physical and all the other aspects, and then they reach the spiritual. It no longer matters to them what they wear. They don't need to wear suits, you know. But they're in the true realm of peace and harmony, you know, and happiness, which is all human beings want. All we ever want is to be happy, you know. And to be not afraid. That's all we want. really, you know. So in order to get that, we do so. We try to achieve that goal in different ways. You know, that's what we do. So if people have to understand out there, and it is the fault of the instructors in martial art who do not talk to their students enough and who do not explain to them enough about why they should practice martial art. They only practice, you know, tell them, okay, you know, do this, do that, go to the tournament and fight, you know, and get a trophy. But they don't lead them beyond that.
It's kind of become the antithesis almost ever. Yep. It's become more an ego trip than anything else.
Yep. Mm-hmm. Yep. So, having said all that, you guys have any questions?
We talked about, you mentioned eat, live, not live to eat, right? And it reminded me that, the picture I have in mind, and we talk about it more, is that it's not that, I don't need to invest in stocks, or I don't need a good house or anything, but rather, it's that does having a house makes me happier, or does it make me worry more? If it makes me worry more, then it's not happiness at all, right? So throw it away.
That's right. Uh-huh.
Yeah, but if it does make me happy,
sure. Why not? That's exactly the point that you have to say, if this is a burden to me, and this is pulling me down, and you know, in my life, and I'm not able to function properly, get rid of it. Mm-hmm. No matter what the laws is, just get rid of it.
In other words, let the all those objects and perhaps the rest of the society serve me, as opposed to me serving somebody else, and for what reason? Make me happy with mine.
You know, the same way, like when we, teach martial art, we teach so many techniques for any given situation, and we'll say, when you are dealing with a situation, and you notice what you originally thought you were going to do is not going to work, don't stay with it. Immediately abandon it. Go to the next one. Don't get stuck on one thought, one idea. That's why you've been taught so many, so you can just move on. And so when you are thinking like that, whether in real life or in a violent situation, you're not going to be afraid. And you're not going to worry about, oh my God, if I give this up.
You don't freeze.
Don't freeze. And even in real life, if you have something, say you bought a house and it's a nightmare for you, you cannot afford to keep it up or something like that. Mm-hmm. And you're constantly, day and night, you're worried about it, you say, how am I going to do this, how am I going to do that? I'm not able to meet with the expenses. So you say, that's it, I'll take a loss and get rid of it. Mm-hmm. And you move to a smaller house. Okay, you worry about it a few days about the loss, mm-hmm. but it's gone. Mm-hmm. You put an end to the story. And that's the only way to do things. Rather than, I'm going to stay in this house and better days will come. And better days may come, may not come. And you might be dead by that because you worried yourself to death. So.
Sensei, mm-hmm. one thing you haven't spoken about is what is required for a student who's starting on this path? What is the attitude and the attributes that are required?
For a student, any student, in anything, be it learning music, be it learning to school, go to school, martial art, whatever be it, the first and foremost thing the student has to have discipline. And he must have the teachers, he must respect the teacher, and he must, at least, I know today is not like that, but the student has no business questioning the teacher on anything besides what that teacher is teaching that day, in that class. Any question pertaining the subject, because the student might not understand that. So he has every right to ask that question. other than, you know, my other instructor or my other teacher said so and so. It's not important. I don't care what he said. This is what I said. Okay? If it's right or wrong, you know, we'll discuss it later. But right now, no. Because I'm the teacher, you're the student. You listen to what I say. You know, if you, there's a doubt in what I'm saying, ask me and I'll answer you. Okay? So, and that comes only if the student respects the teacher. You know? Otherwise, you take the teacher for granted, you know, and you just want to play with him and waste his time asking questions knowing that you don't care for the answer. You know? And so you have to teach the student. First and foremost thing, I will not put up any nonsense. I'm a good person. I teach well, and I will teach you the best I can. I'll answer all your questions pertaining, you know, the class for that day or that period. But if you come here with the intention of, playing with me and trying to make me look like a fool, it's not going to happen until I kick you out of my school. I don't want you in my class. I'll go to the principal and tell him, sir, please take him on. He's nothing but, you know, he's ruining everybody else. And so the first and foremost thing for a student, you know, is to have respect for, you know, the teacher. And most important of all, if the student does not have, you know, respect at home, you know, he's not going to have respect for anybody. If his mother and father are, like in today's world, they are all off at work and making money, and they give the, you know, the children whatever it is that they want to shut them up. You know, to shut them up, they'll say, the guy says, oh, I need a bicycle. Oh, get him a bicycle. Let him go outside and ride, you know, ride around. So he won't bother me. And so they are more or less bribing, you know, the children with so much things that it is going to be hard. How many students are out there, do you know, that come to go to martial arts class and stick it out? Not many. And why do you suppose they don't? Because they don't want the discipline. And they don't want to work hard. A person that doesn't have discipline will not work hard. And then the attributes, you know, of, you know, having respect for somebody, when you are somebody like that, you're automatically, because you respect somebody, I think that you listen to somebody more. And as a young person, the more you listen and the more you take the advice and do what they tell you to do, you know, read more or do your homework or whatever, you're becoming smarter, you know. And smarter, the more smarter you become, you're able to, you know, understand the world around you, you know. You're able to, as you grow up, you know, learn more about the environment, about yourself, about what is out there in the world, you know, and all those things. So you become a better person. And for a martial arts student, the most important thing is to realize that, you know, he's learning to deal with violent situations. And first and foremost thing, he has to have not only physical discipline, but mental discipline of not being afraid. Because that's an easy path to take, to be afraid, you know. But to be brave is not easy. So it makes the person, you know, braver, so he can deal with the situation. So as a martial arts student, you learn this and you become, you know, braver. You know, we can forget about the, you know, violent situation, and we can say that same student who goes to school, because his way of thinking is different, that he has learned in the martial arts school. And in the martial arts school, he has learned that of his own free will and accord, because he went there. His parents didn't tell him to go there.
Yeah.
Isn't it desire?
You know, yeah. And so then what happens, you know, he, same attributes he shows in his other life, wherever he be, you know, whether on the sports field or whether in classroom or whether at home. So martial arts definitely teaches, you know, a student, first and foremost, to be disciplined, because you probably have heard many parents say, oh, I want my son to be disciplined, I'm sending him tomorrow to martial arts class. Well, and again, it depends on the school and the teacher and whatnot, you know. And of course, if that school teaches that student, a martial arts student, you know, the right, you know, discipline and everything, he will become a better student. And he will become a better human being. You know? But it's not going to be overnight. you know, to change the psychology and the philosophy of any person, it's going to be like going to a psychiatrist or a psychologist was going to take time. You have to evolve, you know, by learning. And you just cannot say, oh yeah, my instructor said that and, you know, that's enough, I'll remember this. Again, we go back to the original, you know, you just remembering is not going to help, but you practicing it is what's going to help.
Actually, something that takes us to the flip side, right?
Yeah.
In terms of, there might be students that have the desire to learn it, but how do they go about finding, I mean, not everyone's lucky to stumble upon Kaze Arashi Ryu, right? And nor is it easily or freely available everywhere. So how do they go about looking for a good teacher?
Well, how do they go about, which is true that not every martial arts school out there is, you know, is a fantastic school, is going to make you a great person as you grow along. And any martial arts student that, you know, has an open mind and he's there and he's learning, like all the students that ever came to learn from me, they all had an open mind and they all realized at certain time of their, you know, a martial art practice that they are lacking something. So when, if you're, like, the all of you were true students of martial art, realize that, like I realize myself, there's something lacking in what I know, and I have to find another way, you know. So in order for me to find another way, it's like anything else, you know, somebody goes in this world searching for knowledge or searching for a good teacher or anything, so you're going to have to start a search to find. And you're going to have to spend time and you have to go and, you know, sort of a, they won't let you interview you, you know, the martial art instructor, but you have to go there, sit and see, you know, what is going on. And, you know, then if it's not something, you know, that you wanted, you just move on to something else, you know. And so you have to keep looking because the martial arts world out there, they are not, I doubt very much there are too many good teachers teaching. And the good teachers are only teaching to three or four good people, you know, in their backyards or something like that. But they are not opening big schools and charging $250 a month, you know, and all that stuff. So in the present day world, it is very difficult.
It took me 10 years to find you.
Yeah, you know, it is difficult. So it's, then again, the only thing I can say about that is maybe it depends on your luck.
Yeah.
You know, whether you find that good teacher you're looking for, who can teach you a lot more than martial arts, you know, then just, you know. And because I always thought if to be a good, you know, martial art instructor, you have to train the students, you know, mentally and physically. You just cannot lead them one way. And because if you lead them one way, then they'll be like the old samurai, all that they know is to hurt, you know. And you don't need to know how to hurt because you're, how many people really have fights in this world? You know, say you take 100 people, how many of them you think have gone out and fought every day of their life? You know, in their school or high school, college, you know, wherever, I would say if 5% had them any fight, it would be too much. But that's 90%, 95%, no, you know. So it's not, so martial arts, and of course every day, now everybody out there now is afraid of the environment and they want to learn martial arts, you know, to protect themselves and not be, you know, harassed or whatever. So because that's the main object of martial arts. And those people also, like most of them, that's why I say 95%, they come to a certain stage and then they say, oh, I've learned enough, I can do anything. But they don't realize, no, they cannot do anything. You know, even if I'm a black belt and, you know, I've learned certain things, and if somebody else who's a black belt who has learned a little more than me, because his instructor has taught him, he's definitely going to be better than me. Because he'll be able to, you know, protect himself against my attacks better than me, because he's a little bit beyond me, he knows more than me. So finding a good instructor to stay with for years and years is a very difficult task, I think. I think you have to just look. And then you may, what also happens is a lot of good instructors are not living in, you know, big towns where most youngsters who work and go to take serious martial art classes, you know. And even like, say, you join a traditional martial art like Aikido, you know, you know, unless you stay there for many, many, many years, then they will start, even then I don't know if they teach you anything about, you know, the philosophy and all that stuff, you know, about Aikido. You know? And so because everybody talks about Aikido today, you know, because Yeshiva made a big deal about it, you know, a spiritual deal about it. And, but I don't know of many Aikido students who are very spiritual, you know, or who know the first thing about how to be spiritual. And so, what else can I say?
I can say one thing. We kind of alluded to this, is that we're training to deal with violence, and it's important for us to move with the whole being, mind and body. So, how does one confront this violence? Right? How do you train yourself to confront this kind of violence? Be it out on the street, or it could be a situation where you're fighting a bully who's just harassing you mentally.
Yeah. Well, the answer is very simple. We go back to the simple thing that we said, you know, about fear. First and foremost thing is, remember the example I gave you, somebody pulls a gun on you, you consider yourself dead. So when you're dead, what do you have to lose?
Nothing.
You know? So you train yourself mentally like that every day, whether you're dealing with a situation or not, you prepare yourself mentally like that. If, you know, this happens to me, I am not going to be afraid. You know? You have to teach yourself. Because all these things that you have to learn internally, there's no shortcut to it. You have to learn it yourself. So you have to tell yourself, I'm not going to be afraid. Then you also tell yourself, that doesn't mean I'm going to be brave 100% of the time. You say, initially I'm a human being, and I will probably, a little afraid. But I'm going to overcome it by training my mind. I'm going to overcome that fear, and I am not going to worry about whether I win or lose. I'm not going to worry whether this person, you know, is going to win, and he's going to make a fool out of me, or what. I am not going to worry about anything. And so what happens, everybody says, be calm, right?
Right.
How can you
be calm?
You know? So you become calm. And that's you training yourself. I cannot teach you that, how to do that. But I tell you the way, the principle of how to do it. And you have to learn, you know. And you do it over and over and over, and probably after 6 or 7 months, it becomes everyday affair. You probably, you know, don't have to sit and think about it, you'll just think about it automatically. Whenever you're not doing anything, somebody pulls a gun.
How about visualization?
Huh?
How about visualization? Visualizing the circumstances.
Oh, sure. But the only problem is the visualizing the circumstance is probably going to be, in this situation, because there are too many variables.
Yeah, I know, but say you're afraid to walk home at night and you're afraid that someone's going to attack you, okay? Well, you're training in martial arts. If someone came at me, what are my options? What could I do? What possibilities? Of course, your training is going to have a different...
Because, the training that... You have the physical training how to do something physically. Then, like I just said, you have trained yourself, first and foremost thing, not to be afraid.
Yeah.
And not to worry of the outcome, whether I win or lose. And I am going to go that way. I'm not going to let this person make me walk around here. And also, like, you know, the example I give you, if somebody says he's very mean and he's a tough guy, so what do I say? I tell myself I'm twice as tough and mean. You have to even out. Because if you don't even out the thing in your mind, no amount of visualization is going to help you. First of all, you're not going to visualize anything because you're so afraid.
Yeah.
You know? So, I mean, like, I know visualization and all those things are, you know, like Tony Robbins says, you visualize and everything. It may be very true when you go out there and teach somebody to shoot a gun for him to visualize how he's holding the gun, how he's, you know, aiming and visualizing the bullet going straight through, you know, the target and stuff like that. But there are no variables there. Even there is a variable, like if there's a heavy wind, a crosswind, the bullet's going to wear off no matter how much you visualize. You know? So a lot of these visualization things are now, you know, I believe, you know, that you can do it. But you also have to realize that there's some, you know, because in real life there are variables for every situation.
Yeah.
It is not going to be exactly what you thought it is.
No, but there's certain principles that you've mentioned before about, say you're walking down the street and three guys are coming towards you, and you're sure that they're going to attack you,
yeah.
Right? So then what is your principle? You're going to go for the strongest one and try and take them out.
Yeah.
You attack first, right?
Yeah.
Okay, so that type of thing.
Yeah, taking on, there is no such thing as far as a principle is concerned that you're going to take out the strongest guy. Mm-hmm. Because you don't know who the strongest guy is. Mm-hmm. You know, because in that situation, there's no time for you to say, mm-hmm. Oh, he's the strongest guy, I'm going to take him out. Mm-hmm. The only thing you know is you have been taught how to fight multiple people. All right? So given that situation, the way they're coming towards you,
right?
You know, all three of them in a straight line, you know, or all three of them, one guy ahead and two guys behind. What, how the formation is, you know, that's your variable there. So, you know, the strongest guy might be in the back and the weakest guy ahead. You'll have to take him out first,
yeah.
You know. And there again is the principle that of multiple fighting where you are not going to be in the center.
Yeah.
Never make yourself the center, because you can't turn and look 360 degrees. You know, so you make them the middle and go around. So if they change the situation, you're able to see what the variable is, and you can accordingly act accordingly. But if you are in the center, like the martial arts movies, you're dead. You know, it's not gonna work, because you cannot see all around you.
So it's not visualization, it's acting according to principles that you've learned from your sensei or whatever.
Exactly.
Applying those principles to the situation as it comes up.
Yeah. And a lot of those principles you can also apply in your general life. Mm-hmm. You know, the way you live your life every day, a lot of them can be applied.
Such as?
Because whether it's a violent situation or a situation, you know, that you're in a crowd and you don't want to be there and you want to get away from there, you know, anything, you know, you could use a lot of, you know, a lot of principles regarding fighting, you know, you may not be able to apply in your real life, you know, like, you know, making somebody, all the people you have to fight, making them the center. That's only true for that situation, you know. That principle can be true for something else. But everything has principle, you know.
Well, say you're in a boardroom and you're in a conflict with another person in that room, and he's come out very strong against your proposal or something. Would you deflect it? Would you go behind? How would you?
Much like that, Savaki, how would you deal with it?
Yeah.
Well, if that person is, don't forget there's a variable there, like, you know, if that guy happens to be your boss. You know? So again, given the situation, you know, that violation, like most bosses, you better not go against them.
Yeah, but what if you're not afraid?
Hey, if you're not afraid, then, you know, it'd be first and foremost thing, you have to say, I'm not afraid, and if I have to look for another job, I'll do it. Yeah, I'll do it. I'll look for another job, and then, you know, tell them what you think of it. But if, you know, somebody is invested in 5-6 years of their life on a job, and he's married and he's got a single home, he is not going to have the guts to do that. Because immediately he says, oh my God, my house, my wife, my children. You know, because he's a slave to the world.
Yeah.
And there's no escape for him. But if he said, I'm tired of this and I want to escape from this, go ahead and save the guy. And who knows, he might get lucky. You know, the boss might say, oh, okay, this guy is brave and he talks to me, you know, and he told me the right thing, I'll keep him.
Or if he really believed in what he was saying.
Yeah, I mean, look at Bush. No, you, nobody can tell him anything about anything that's bad. No, all his advisors will not go and tell him anything bad, because he will pounce on them. You know? So what do you do with a guy like that?
You resign.
Yeah. So, you know, it's, because don't forget, like, in this world, you know, for every principle, for every, you know, question, you know, everything, there's an exception. Nature has made it that there's an exception for every single thing. Nothing, no answer, and no philosophy, no principle is 100%. This is it, man. You know this thing, you don't have to worry.
Why is that? Because things evolve?
Yeah.
Because there's infinite possibilities?
The variables. You know, God had made it just like, you know, nature had made it, so this for this, that for that, that for that, it'd be great, but he didn't.
It'd also be mighty boring.
Yeah. And just keep going and going and going, you know. And, well, that is the thing, beauty of Kaze Arashi Ryu, when you learn the principles and the Tai Samadhi you are with it, it helps you. You know the principle, and you move a certain way, and you can move a different way. Tai Samadhi is also nothing but a principle.
Sensei, one thing most martial artists pay a lot of just lip service to, right? At least from what I have seen. And in my opinion, they haven't even got a grasp of what it means, is training for awareness, right? Essentially, awareness, which is not just in the ring or on the mat.
On the mat.
How you generally interact with life.
Right.
How do you go about it? I mean, some martial artists may have just heard about it, maybe had glimpses of that scene. How do you go about training for that?
Training your student?
Yeah, training your students or training oneself to
First and foremost thing, the student has to, show you that he's, he has that type of mind. He has that type of desire to learn beyond martial arts. Because the minute you start talking like this to a regular class, you will lose all the students, most of them. Because they'll think you're a nut job and you're going off somewhere else. I come here to learn martial arts, I don't want to hear that nonsense, I don't know this shit, man, I just want to learn martial arts. So you have to teach them and teach them and eventually feel them out. Like when I first started with you guys, I was not talking to you about all these things. I was just saying, okay, come on, let's do this, let's do that, And that's all I did till you guys started asking me questions. You started asking me questions. And then I started talking and I started answering. Before that, I never did, because I don't know what you are like, And if I start, on a higher level of talking to you, you probably would say, we just came here to learn martial arts. You won't say that to me, but you'll say it to yourself, and you'll probably say, I don't think I'm going there. He always talks, After class, man, we're there for an hour and a half. He's not letting us go home. All we do is talk, So that could happen easily, A lot of students. And like even in New York, in Sensei Valeri, he's good at talking. When he used to talk, There were not many students. About three or four of us, you know. Or that's it.
Six, seven, eight.
Yep. And the rest of the guys would be gone. Yeah.
But what can one do, Sensei, to increase that sense of awareness? You know, that I don't know how to express this right, where you're basically truly able to see, you know? It happens sometimes on the mat, especially when on the mat, you're truly able to see. It's just a different, it's a totally different set of awareness.